hear me. Thanks to Dr. Sujit Chauhan. Having attended these CMEs over the last 5 years, I really feel a lot wiser. Well, today's topic is solitary pulmonary nodule, earlier known as coil lesion, but this is the new terminology. I would just like to mention a few things. You see, 1 to 3 centimeters in size. Bronchogenic CA, as and when is symptomatic, it has already spread. It is only 10 to 11% of patients who are operable, otherwise the treatment is palliative. When you see a coil lesion or a solitary pulmonary nodule, the question is whether it is malignant. One has to really see whether to observe, see the old x-rays, or when to intervene, do a PET CT, look for calcifications. All these things need to be looked into. When to do PET CT, I think Dr. Devavrat Arya will make us wiser. He's a senior consultant in medical oncology in Max Super-speciality Medicine from Government Medical College, Surat, South Gujarat University. He did his GM in medical oncology from Gujarat Cancer and Research Institute, BJ Medical College, Ahmedabad University. His special interests are in breast cancer, head and neck cancer, musculoskeletal and gynae cancer. Dr. Devavrat Arya.
At the outset, Dr. Mangla, thank you very much for the kind introduction. Dr. Chauhan, I think this is working. Am I audible at the back? Am I audible now?
Yeah.
So thank you, Dr. Chauhan. Thank you. He's a pulmonologist. So I think that he is a much bigger expert at this topic that I am. I'm a medical oncologist. I am from Alarazar. I'm very proud of that fact. And I think I've attended a few meetings and I already know a few of you. I am much junior to most of you. And therefore, I say this repeatedly at different meetings that I get to speak in, that I cannot give a lecture to people who are as wise, as senior, as experienced you are.
You may not be as wise.
So I cannot be as wise. Agreed. So I can only give my perspective, and I get a lot of perspective from you about life, about practice, and I also hope to get some perspective about this topic as well. So again, a very challenging topic, and thank you, sir. This is the first time I'm talking about a solitary pulmonary nodule, because we are a referral based practice and most oncologists would get it, you know, what we call as a paka-paka case. Mostly pulmonologists biopsy, bronchoscopic biopsy, kuch karke bhej dete hain, we already know. So the thing that we need to do is to stage the patient and then decide the appropriate treatment. And when we decided on this topic nearly 20-25 days back, I just thought about, when did I last see a case which was actually purely a solitary pulmonary nodule? And I've been practicing medical oncology since 2011, so 6 years, not a very long time. But there was just one case. So 30-year-old guy with an x-ray with an opacity which is about 3 centimeters in size. Approximately, you know, x-ray is not a very good modality to measure sizes. And the patient had just been referred to me because we had started oncology in that particular hospital. Looked innocuous, got a CT scan done, and we actually on the CT scan realized that they had multiple nodules and lesion in the liver as well, and eventually the biopsy turned out positive for small cell CLN. So a lesion which was presenting as a very small opacity on an X-ray was actually a disseminated malignancy. And as sir very rightly said, very rightly put into perspective, this is the stage where you can actually catch lesions which are in a curable stage. Anything bigger, any lesion that's actually a mass, has a greater potential to spread to distant areas and then, you know, go beyond the scope of cure. One more point that I'll point out, there's so much of explosion that is happening in this field that we are discussing today in our internal academic meeting. We're talking about treatment of non-small cell lung cancer, which are EGFR mutated. And since 2010, the standard of care has changed 4 times. So this is the pace at which development is happening. So, you know, EGFR mutated lung cancer, I was in Madrid last week, there was a presentation on a drug called osimertinib, and first line data suggests progression free survival of 18 months. So patient is taking this tablet and a median PFS is 18 months. So even though the treatment remains palliative, on a first line therapy, the progression free survival is 18 months. The overall survival, which is expected, the calculated overall survival for that subset of patients is about 55 months. So again, lung cancer is an increasingly diagnosed condition in India, and I think this topic becomes very relevant. So we don't have Indian data. Sir, if you have to add something to it, feel free to do it. But most of the data of incidence of solitary pulmonary nodules come from screening studies. So a lot of low-dose CT scan screening programs have been, you know, going on in the West, and they are generally targeting heavy smokers, people who are described as having at least had 30 pack years of smoking. And in those programs, the incidence of solitary pulmonary nodule is as high as 50%. Now, if you look at a general epidemiological reports where you are actually targeting a normal population, on a CT scan, the incidence may be as high as 31%. As sir said, a solitary pulmonary nodule is defined as a lesion which is less than 3 centimeters of size. So anything bigger is actually a mass. Characteristically, it is defined as something which is well circumscribed and is surrounded by a normal pulmonary membrane. This is the definition. Now, what appears on a as a solid for malignancy and treated as such. Now, characteristically, these patients are asymptomatic. And so even if it's a malignancy, it's likely to be early. But if the lesion is larger, say it's a mass more than 3 centimeters, then sometimes there may be symptoms. And characteristically, there would not be any other findings on the scan. There should not be. So there should not be any mediastinal nodes, there should not be any effusion or any other finding as such. Now the focus of evaluation of a solitary pulmonary nodule is to assess the probability of malignancy and then decide whether the patient requires a biopsy, whether it's a surgical biopsy or a needle biopsy or a bronchoscopic biopsy. That's the main focus of evaluation for patients who present with a solitary pulmonary nodule. But remember that if a patient has a solitary pulmonary nodule but has already got symptoms, then you have to treat it as a suspected case of cancer. Then it no longer is a SPN case. It has to be treated as a suspected case of cancer, which would mean that more often than not, the patient needs to be subjected to a diagnostic biopsy. So what are the possible reasons of solitary pulmonary nodules? They could be both benign and malignant. Thankfully, even in heavy smokers, most of the solitary pulmonary nodules are benign. For example, in one of the studies, and I've quoted this because I think we like getting some figures. So in a Canadian study of lung cancer, which was done by the British Columbia Cancer Agency, you know, in about 12,000 cases where there was a solitary pulmonary nodule, only 144, that is 1% per malignant. So the figure could actually be very small. As small as 1%. However, we still need to be alert and actually differentiate cases which could be malignant from those who are not. Now, this incidence is a Canadian incidence. This was actually a study on smokers. So obviously, the data for India would differ. The population sensitivities, the incidence of cancer differs from one region to the other, and therefore the figures may be different from it. Now, this is a busy slide. I wanted to keep it busy, and this is from today, a lot of images from today. But these are the possible differential diagnoses of solitary pulmonary nodule. So it could be a malignancy, it could be a benign condition, and we'll come to details of that. So when we talk about malignancy, obviously it could be a primary lung cancer. Just for information, most of the solitary pulmonary nodules, when it's a primary lung cancer, it's most likely to be an adenocarcinoma. The adenocarcinoma is usually present as a solitary pulmonary nodule. In Western studies, accounting for nearly 50% of malignant cases of solitary pulmonary nodule. Squamous and large cell carcinoma can also produce as solitary pulmonary nodules. Sometimes metastatic cancer may present as a single nodule. Characteristically, they have multiple nodules. But occasionally, you may have a single nodule that we in our terminology now call as oligo single site oligo metastasis. But you have to remember, and that is where history is important, that if a patient has had a history of any malignancy and presents with a solitary pulmonary nodule, there is a 25% chance of that nodule of being malignant. So any history of malignancy and then a patient presents with a solitary pulmonary nodule, I in my practice would certainly subject that patient to a tissue biopsy without any reason. 1 in 4 is high. Rarely other tumors like neuroendocrine tumors, carcinoids may also present as a well circumscribed nodule. More often than not, it is the benign etiologies we come across. In India, you know, we always talk about tuberculosis. Tuberculosis is high on the differential diagnosis list of possibly everything. And even in the West, you know, granulomas are responsible for 80% of solitary pulmonary nodules. They see a lot of fungal infections over there. I think we are also increasingly seeing fungal infections in malignancies, especially patients who are on chemotherapy. We come across a lot of scans where patients have been immunosuppressed and then they produce as come as a nodule, and then we have to investigate because they already have a diagnosis of malignancy. A lot of times it comes out as a fungal nodule. So I think that's very high on the differential diagnosis list. So is tuberculosis. What we need to remember is that classically on a CT scan, benign nodule, especially a granuloma, is a very well demarcated and fully calcified lesion. So I'll show you some images just to make it a little bit more interesting. Rarely infections with abscess forming bacteria, staph, pneumocystis, jirovecki can also present as RSP, and sometimes they cavitate. Some other causes include a hematoma. We know hematomas are you know, benign conditions usually seen in middle age. And there's this fancy term called popcorn calcification, which is actually seen in very few cases. But then if there's a popcorn calcification, there's a very high likelihood that it's a hematoma. And other benign tumors like fibromas, leiomyomas can also present as solitary pulmonary nodule. So this is just a very interesting picture of a pulmonary hematoma. So these are the calcifications that you can see. So this is the characteristic popcorn calcification. And this is actually nearly pathognomic of hematoma. Other benign etiologies include vascular, which would include arteriovascular malformation. This is one condition where a contrast non-CT scan would probably be more justified, and one could actually, if one is able to identify a bleeding artery, then this is perhaps pathognomic and you should probably not do a biopsy. Other vascular, rarely pulmonary contusion, hematomas. Other inflammatory conditions like rheumatoid arthritis, granulomatosis, sarcoidosis, can also rarely present as a solitary pulmonary nodule. Most of the time, these patients won't have a diagnosis beforehand. But rarely, a solitary pulmonary nodule would actually trigger the initial diagnosis of these conditions. So I think that also needs to be kept in mind. And rarely pseudotumor, so loculated fluid in interlobal fissures, subpleural dependent entelectasis, mucoid impaction, things which can actually be, you know, cleared off by maneuvers like post-diuresis, prone positioning, cough assistance, and they can also really present this solitary pulmonary nodule. So this is again not my image, this is from a site. So this is an arteriovenous malformation. So you can actually identify that this is the nodule and there is a feeding artery, and it's taking up contrast, and I think because it's an artery, there would be a lot of contrast, and this is how it can be differentiated. And look, actually, in these cases, a biopsy may be actually harmful. It may trigger a bleed. So this is an example of an SPM because of malformation, and this is an infarct. So this is a cavitating nodule, and there you see an infarct. So this is a PET image, and rarely even benign conditions can have some uptake, and there's some uptake both in this nodule and in the infarct. And so PET CT is not the final word in a lot of conditions, but then this is how an infarct would look like. So as I said, as a clinician, the initial evaluation has to, you know, direct to, you know, not estimate the likelihood of malignancy. You just need to see whether there is a possibility of malignancy, and we need to do further work. So what we need to do is look at clinical features, look at radiology, and then that means that you have to have a good CT scanner, and also need to have a good radiologist, apart from your own judgment, to be able to determine the the possibility of malignancy. And then there's some quantitative models, quantitative tools available. So I was talking to Dr. Grewal just a little bit earlier. I'll share one of those tools. So there are some quantitative tools also available to estimate the possibility of malignancy. And the likelihood of malignancy then would determine further management as particularly the need for a biopsy. Now there are some things that one needs to do. So these are points which are important in history. One is patient age. So as you can clearly see, older the age, greater the risk of there being a malignancy. So there was one study which suggested that patients who are more than 55 were, you know, probably a 65% chance of harboring a malignancy in the nodule versus 33% for those who are 50. And there's another study. So younger the patient, lesser the chance of malignancy. I know in real world, you know, these are just, you know, they just aid you. They cannot, you know, you cannot use these figures to differentiate. But I think the take home message from this is that the older you are, if you have, the older your patient is, and if there is a nodule, you have to suspect malignancy. Then obviously presence of other risk factors, smoking is the biggest risk factor. So a history of heavy smoking would certainly tilt the balance in favor of there being a possibility of malignancy. So would be history of prior malignancy and family history. Now imaging, most of us would get an X-ray, or most of the time the patient would become an X-ray. Most often, more often than not, I've seen is that, you know, a solitary pulmonary nodule is actually a CT-based diagnosis. But what we, you know, CT is actually one of the most important tools in making a judgment about the possibility of malignancy. And there's also a role of functional imaging, one of which is PET. So CT scan is considered one of the gold standards, but as Sir said, it is very important to secure whatever old imaging that may be there. So if the patient has had a CT scan earlier or an X-ray earlier, and you have an X-ray now, those comparisons would actually help you a lot in determining whether this is a stable nodule or this is a growing nodule, and therefore what is the need for a biopsy. So what is recommended is a thin slice, a 1 millimeter slice scan for all patients for a solitary pulmonary nodule. So you may have come with an inferior quality of CT scan, but you need to do the best CT scan that you can. Contrast enhancement typically is not required unless you are suspecting arteriovenous malformation. And CT features that actually help determine the possibility of malignancy include size, borders, calcification, attenuation, and growth. And therefore, for a lot of these things would actually require the help of your radiologist. Now, size has been found out to be an independent predictor for malignancy. And smaller the nodule, lesser the chance of it being malignant. So a subcentimetric nodule, when we talk about a nodule which is less than a centimeter, the chance of malignancy is as low as 1 in 20 approximately, or even less. But as the size goes bigger, so a nodule which is more than 2 centimeters, the chance of malignancy is as high as 50%. Again, these are not absolute figures. This is mostly Western data, and India data is certainly going to be. But I think size can certainly be used. The bigger the nodule, higher should your index of suspicion should be. Attenuation, now this is something that your radiologist would tell you, and with experience, all of us are able to you know, see whether the nodule is a solid nodule or a subsolid nodule. So subsolid nodules include those with pure ground loss attenuation. I'll show an image. I'm sure you all have seen those CT scans. I'll nevertheless share an image. So it could be what is characteristically called as a non-solid nodule. Or sometimes there can be nodules where there is a little bit of ground glassing and also a solid component which is referred to as a part solid or semi-solid nodule. As a rule of thumb, any solid nodule which is less than 8 millimeters, it's highly unlikely that it is going to be malignant. So again, size criteria and then attenuation. Solid nodules more than 8 millimeter have a greater likelihood of malignancy, and this is where there is a role for functional imaging, including a PET scan. Now, subsolid and non-solid nodules actually have a greater likelihood of being malignant. This is what we need to remember. So a ground glass nodule is actually very tricky, and I'll discuss about the size of that. And the risk of malignancy in a subsolid nodule that has persisted over 3 months can be as high as 10 to 15%. So that's why sometimes, you know, serial follow-up scans may be necessary. But if a semi-solid or a subsolid lesion persists for 3 months, that there's a very high chance of malignancy. Now, increasingly, what we are seeing are subsolid nodules, because even in India, adenocarcinoma is increasing. So India, most figures do suggest that still it's squamous cell carcinoma which is predominant. It's happening in the West that adenocarcinoma is predominant, and we are seeing, especially in urban areas, that adenocarcinoma as a subtype of lung cancer is on the increase, and adenocarcinoma is what is going to present as a subsolid nodule, and therefore it's increasingly see those kind of solitary permanent nodules. So this is an example of a ground glass solitary permanent nodule. So it looks like a ground glass, something which is at times difficult to see, but you can clearly make out. And when you see something like this, this should be at least 1-1.5 centimeters in size. This is something which has to be treated with a lot of suspicion. In contrast to this, look at a benign pulmonary nodule. So look at this lesion, look at the boundaries, look at how well demarcated it is compared to the previous one it's very difficult to differentiate the boundary from the rest of the pulmonary parenchyma, but this one was a benign nodule and very well, you know, defined boundaries which are there. And I think this is characteristically a benign nodule which can probably be observed. So the second aspect of evaluation is growth. So to assess growth, you have to have a comparative image. So that's why it's important that if the patient has had some previous imaging, some previous CT scan, X-ray, get hold of it just to compare and then see whether it's growing. If he doesn't have it, then obviously you have to use other tools. But as I said, any nodule that is growing clearly on an imaging has a high risk of malignancy and should be biopsy. There's no doubt about it. Any growing lesion has to be biopsy. The doubling time varies, but anything which is growing in less than 20 days is highly unlikely to be malignant. It's most likely to be infectious. Characteristically, the high-grade non-small cell lung cancers grow with a growing time of about 300 to 400 days, doubling time. So a nodule which is 2 centimeter would probably in 3 to 6 months time would probably be 3.5-4 centimeters. Although rarely, some of the low-grade adenocarcinomas actually take a longer period of time to grow. But nevertheless, I think thumb rule here is if it's growing, it has to be malignant. If it's growing very fast within 20 days, probably it's infectious. But if it is growing, you probably should biopsy. As we said, other features that we need to focus are the borders. So we saw that slide of the CT scan. Anything which has a smooth border is less likely to be malignant. Anything which has scalloped, speculated border is more likely to be malignant. I'll share an image of a speculated nodule as well. Calcification is also important. Any eccentric calcification should raise the concern of malignancy. That is probably a thumb. You know, especially in what we call as scar carcinoma. So any old granulomatous lesion, you have an eccentric calcification. That should trigger a suspicion of malignancy. I think this is a condition we would probably come across very frequently in our country. And in contrast to that, a popcorn or a concentric or a central or a diffuse homogeneous calcification is a marker of the lesion being benign. Again, remember that these are not pathognomic findings, so these are not the only criteria that would differentiate a benign from a malignant. These are suggestive. There's some evidence to suggest, I don't know how much value this would have, but I came across it and I thought I'll discuss it. Any nodule which is located in the upper lobe has a higher chance of being malignant. So this is probably an epidemiological, statistical, anecdote that you remember. So this is again a speculated nodule. So this is the nodule over here, and you look at the borders here, you can clearly see that, you know, these are the speculation, and this is highly suspicious. And this would certainly trigger a suspicion for malignancy. Again, another nodule, you can see again, these are not smooth borders. These are, you know, so you can clearly see the serration. And so it should certainly trigger a risk. And then centric calcification, probably this is not that visible. So this is the area of calcification over here, and this is the nodule. So this is an eccentric calcification. Again, eventually this turned out to be a squamous cell carcinoma. So eccentric calcification, spiculation, serration, whatever you call it, I think this is highly suspicious for a malignancy. Now, increasingly we use PET scans. PET scans, you know, is a tool that is now very commonly available at very affordable prices. Malignancy size and attenuation. So if you have a high suspicion of malignancy, PET scan does not happen. So if you have, you know, speculated margins, evidence of growth, eccentric calcification, either of these, PET scan will add a little value. You know, what it may do is be a surrogate for staging for the diagnosed cancer later on. So if you have all these findings, probably should do biopsy and not rely on this. Similarly, if the possibility of malignancy is very low, so a subcentimetric solid nodule, which is not growing, probably PET scan would still not guide you towards malignancy. So it is those intermediate areas where you are really not sure whether, you know, a biopsy is needed or not, you could do a PET scan, look at the uptake, and then decide. Unfortunately, there is no standard cutoff for the FDG uptake. So traditionally, we have used 2.5 as the cutoff. So anything with an SUV of less than 2.5 is probably benign. More than 2.5 is probably malignant, but unfortunately that doesn't hold true. With greater experience, we know that a lesser FDG uptake may still be malignant, a higher FDG uptake may still be benign. I had one patient who was a known case of breast cancer, came with a solitary pulmonary nodule on a PET scan, which is 2 centimeters in size, and she was sure that this was malignant, and she came to me for treatment. And the uptake was about 4. But since there had been a significant gap between the last chemotherapy, the patient had a disease-free interval of nearly 2.5 years, I thought it was prudent to do a biopsy. We did a biopsy and turned out to be tuberculosis. So PET scan may not be the final word. So there can be false positive, as I discussed. So there can be infectious reasons for the false positivity. There could be inflammatory conditions. You could have tuberculosis, you could have pneumonia, you could have rheumatoid nodules and sarcoidosis. We very commonly deal with these conditions where you do a PET scan for staging and you find nodules and which are difficult to characterize, and all you can do is follow them up serially. There can also be false negatives. As I said, minimally invasive adenocarcinomas, mucinous adenocarcinomas, there would be very little FDG uptake and they would be false negative on a PET scan. So this is a neuroendocrine tumor, and you can see this is the lesion. It's not hot. It's not hot at all. So this is indeed a malignancy. But it's a low-grade tumor, and that's why it's not picking up. So it's actually better defined on the CT aspect of the scan rather than the PET scan. And they eventually did a biopsy and it turned out to be a low-grade neuroendocrine tumor. So there have been other models which have been tools that have been created. Unfortunately, very few of them have been validated and they are not commonly used. But there are factors, and I'll share one such model with that. But there have been various studies, and studies are comforting in the sense that a clinician's judgment has a high concordance with these prediction models. So sometimes we talk about our intuition or our gut feeling. And so if you are, in your judgment you feel that this is highly likely to be suspicious, probably even the model would concur with you and show that there is a high possibility of malignancy. And that's why it's very important to actually act on, you know, what your feeling is about a particular thing. So various models have been calculated. So this is an example of a model. We don't use these models. It's more of a clinical and radiological judgment. But what they take into account is they calculate a probability of malignancy, and they take into account factors like age, number, the smoking history, presence of a previous diagnosis of malignancy, speculation, size, and location. And then they create a score, and then they that helps us determine the probability of malignancy and the need for subsequent biopsy. Now, second and the final half of my talk, what is the management strategy? So the management option includes, for a solitary pulmonary nodule, a CT-based surveillance or a sampling, which could either be a resection or a biopsy. Now, many of us are inherently aggressive. And sometimes the patient is also aggressive. He wants a diagnosis and he doesn't want to sit with. And early stage lung cancer, as Sir suggested, stage 1 and 2 has probably got a 70 to 80% 5-year cure rate. But then a lot of these nodules will turn out to be benign. So a lot of these procedures would turn out to be, you know, probably unnecessary retrospectively. In the contrast, a less aggressive approach is probably, you know, you leave behind a nodule, do a CT surveillance, it will grow and probably then, if it's a malignancy, grow into a stage which is beyond the realm of cure. So in a real world, there has to be a middle path. We cannot surgically resect all nodules that we see, and we cannot do a CT surveillance on all of them. And I think this is where we need to decide our strategy. So I think for me, the easiest patient who has a previous imaging. Admittedly, these are rare patients. But if a patient has a previous imaging and you see a nodule which is stable, so by definition, any nodule that is solid and is stable for 2 years, or a subsolid nodule which is stable for 5 years. So remember, that is the duration of follow-up that the patient needs. A solid nodule stable for 2 years, subsolid groundless nodule which remains stable for 5 years is probably somebody who you can just wait to watch. But any sign of growth has to be biopsied. Now, most of the times the patient would not have a prior imaging. You just come with a CT scan which has been done for some reason for the first time. Then what you need to do is differentiate between a solid and a subsolid or a non-solid. So if it's a solid nodule and with more than 8 millimeter in size, then you have to look at the characteristics. You have to look at the border, look at the calcification, look at the smoking history and age. And if it's a well-defined circumscribed border, you know, there's very little smoking history, the size is not big, not 2.5-3 centimeters, then you can actually put them to a surveillance, do a CT scan at 3 to 6 months and subsequently 9 to 12 months, 18. So probably do 2 or 3 CT scans, see if they're stable, and if at 2 years they're stable, just put it out. Now, if there are suspicious signs, but you're not sure that this is likely to be malignant, so probably a smoker, some speculation, but no calcification, or non-smoker with some speculation, or a heavy smoker with a solitary pulmonary, may be well circumscribed. So you are in doubt. This is where the role of PET scan will come. So subject these patients to a PET scan. If there is an uptake, certainly subject them to a PET scan. If there's no uptake, you'll probably put them onto a CT scan. But if there are highly characteristic signs of a malignancy, heavy smoker, speculation, calcification, then PET scan would not help you, have to biopsy. A solid nodule which is less than 8 millimeter is a nightmare for an interventionist. So they cannot do anything about it. Most likely, if they attempt an FNA or a biopsy, they'll miss it. Certainly be missed on a bronchoscopy. Even a PET scan with a nodule which is less than 8 millimeter is usually not very informative. So these are the tricky nodules. So if the nodule is less than 6 millimeter, and I have seen, you know, we see increasingly nodules that are 5, 6, 7 millimeters in size which are being increasingly reported. So the quality of scanners are improving. So if it's less than 6 millimeter, put them on follow-up even if they're suspicious. But if they're 6 to 8, you know, then they have to have a regular follow-up, look for growth and subject to a biopsy if this suspicion is high or stability is equal. When it comes to a part solid nodule, since they have a greater likelihood of malignancy, your milestones have to be a little bit earlier. So a part solid nodule less than 6 millimeter does not require a follow-up. A part solid nodule more than 6 millimeter, in spite of whatever features there would be on a CT scan, should underscore a CT scan at 3 to 6 months, even if you have very low index of suspicion for malignancy, So nodule that remains unchanged for 5 years, you can forget, but nodule that grows within that period of time or has a solid component that grows to more than 8 millimeter, then should be considered suspicious for malignancy. A lot of times you have multiple nodules. As I said, the dominant nodule is considered the solitary pulmonary nodule, but in clinical practice, you need to assess each of these nodules as suspicious for malignancy, do a risk assessment for malignancy, and subject to a biopsy. lot of times the smaller nodules are not able to guide us what the possibility of malignancy could be, and in those situations that dominate, the biggest nodule should probably be used as a guide. So this is looking suspicious, probably do biopsy, but this is not good. And all of those nodules are less than 6 millimeters. Unless the patient has a known history of malignancy or is immunocompromised, in which case he may have an opportunistic infection. If it's less than 6 millimeter in the absence of immunocompromise or malignancy, or previous history of malignancy, just forget about it. What are the biopsy approaches available? The biopsy approaches available include surgical biopsy, which is something I'll talk about, and a non-surgical biopsy. So non-surgical biopsy could be bronchoscopic transbronchial biopsy, inhaled aspiration. Increasingly, we are using endobronchial ultrasounds, and it seems that the EBUS procedure actually has added sensitivity and specificity. And these are ideal for the large or centrally located lesions. The more central the location is, more amenable it is to a bronchoscopic procedure, whether it's pure bronchoscopy or EBUS. Whereas we talk about a wax biopsy, which is an open biopsy where a surgeon goes in and resects the tumor and the nodule in its entirety. That remains the gold standard, and that in fact sometimes could add on. And you know, if you add on a mediastinal nodal dissection or a lobectomy, that could actually be a definitive procedure if it turns out to be a malignancy on a frozen section. So patients who are surgical candidates and have a high risk for malignancy should actually ideally be undergoing a wax and a wedge resection of the lesion, which should be subjected to a frozen section, and then decision should be taken likewise. But if there's an intermediate risk of malignancy, probably you could do a transthoracic biopsy or a bronchoscopic biopsy, or if the patient, the risk is high, but the patient is not fit for a wax. Most of the times, I don't do wax, but most of the times they do a visual inspection. But sometimes they do palpate the lung and then they try and find out other nodules as well and then do a resection of those nodules as well. Coming more to CT surveillance, as I said, I think on a CT surveillance is very important to monitor the change in nodule size, and I think the best way to do it is to use a thin slice CT scan. And as I have repeatedly said during this talk, that any growing nodule has to be treated with a lot of suspicion. So summary of this presentation and take home message, we characteristically define a solitary pulmonary nodule which is 3 or less than 3 centimeter in size. Most of these are benign. For all the patients who have had a solitary pulmonary nodule on some sort of imaging, a thin slice CT scan is indicated. Serial imaging, especially if cold imaging is available, can help define whether there is growth or not and therefore need for malignancy. One can use clinical judgment or models to define the need of malignancy, but the risk of malignancy, and anything that's growing should be biopsied. Any solid nodule stable for 2 years can be observed, is probably benign. Any subsolid nodule that has been observed for 5 years is again benign. For a patient which has a solitary pulmonary solid nodule for more than 8 millimeter, if your clinical suspicion of malignancy is high, then biopsy is indicated. For intermediate size lesion, a PET scan would be helpful. For a low risk of malignancy, you can just do another scan after 3 to 6 months. For a patient with a solid or subsolid nodule with less than 6 millimeter, no routine follow-up is required. But a 6 to 8 millimeter subsolid nodule certainly would need to do serial imaging, and a pure ground loss more than 6 millimeter, there has to be a scan for at least 6 to 12 months later and an assessment for growth. Again, the time interval for the CT scan could vary. One needs to use our clinical judgment and also think about the possible radiation exposure of a CT scan. If the CT scan suggests that there are multiple nodules, then each nodule needs to be assessed individually. The choice of sampling procedure would probably be guided by the probability of malignancy. So a high probability of malignancy, probably that patient would be subjected to a transthoracic or a bronchoscopic biopsy. Other features would also obviously be location and size and local expertise that is available. And if surveillance is chosen, then a thin slice CT scan is necessary. Thank you very much. And I think I'm open to questions.
And in case, patient is a smoker I think you should be more sensitive. I would just like to give you one example. One of my patients was a very heavy smoker, coronary artery disease, all problem, he will not leave a cigarette. Usually will come with COPD and will get well. And this time, you know, his cough was not getting better. And he had streaky hemoptysis. We did a chest x-ray and a CT scan and we found a nodule. And we also found that he had a mediastinal lymph node and he was stage 3A. He had a scan 2 years earlier. Would you believe that the site at which the mass was there, or this nodule was there, there was a, ball pin tip. That size of a lesion was there at that point of time. And we were wondering whether we should have acted at that point of time. But at time, you know, the patient is a very heavy smoker, has exposure to some asbestos, one should be more sensitive. Any questions?
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Mangala. So, Dr. Arya. So, definition of solitary pulmonary nodules opacity less or equal to 3 centimeters and lesions larger than 3 centimeters are considered masses and probably treated as malignant until proved otherwise. Would that be true?
I would agree.
You would agree. Okay. So, SPN mostly are benign but may represent an early stage of lung cancer. So, how would you diagnose that? By serial CT scans?
So, I think, as I said, look at the history, age, smoking history, family history, exposure to asbestos, that happens very rarely these days, but you may still have people who have been exposed. That's number one. Number two, look at the characteristics on the imaging. So any atypical finding, eccentric calcifications, peculated borders, and if it's going. So if at the initial evaluation you have a high index of suspicion, I would not hesitate to go in for a biopsy and PET scan if there is some lesser index of suspicion. But where the probability of malignancy is less, so very small nodule which would anyhow not be available to a biopsy, where a PET scan would not be very helpful, that usually includes solid nodules less than 8 or subsolid nodules less than 6 to 8 millimeters in size. That's where I would probably subject these patients to a surveillance CT scan. The frequency varies with the kind of nodule, but if it has to be a simple, you know, thumb rule, probably at 3 to 6 months.
Right. So talking about the PET scan, lower sensitivity for small and slow-growing lesions, especially the bronchoalveolar carcinomas, one study showed 100% false negative.
Agreed.
True.
So I think that's why it's important.
Yeah.
I mean, we have DNP residents, and I'm one of the guides for them. So I tell them, you know, PET scan is never the final.
Absolutely.
So as I discussed, I had a case which was very PET positive. In fact, one of my colleagues thought that it was a recurrence, but it turned out to be tuberculosis. At the same time, you know, a low-grade, slow-growing tumor would not have an SPT uptake. And therefore, these are the lesions where you depend more on history and the pattern of growth and the pattern on a CT scan rather than the uptake on the PET.
Bronchial adenomas, probably complete surgical resection is needed because of its recurrence.
So,
malignancy?
If we talk about benign lesions, usually I don't think adenomas are risk factor for malignancy. Dr. Mangla, if you refer, please. So they are not. But a lot of times, you know, you actually end up diagnosing low grade adenocarcinomas. We have had one case where there's actually an adenocarcinoma in CT.
Right.
This would certainly have grown into a malignancy. So, you know, I think the idea is to also identify these low grade cancers or in situ cancer which could turn into a malignancy later.
So you do an endoscopic resection?
No. Most of the times,
especially in high risk for elderly people, with a laser.
No. So if we are talking about a biopsy procedure, it's a wax-based resection.
Okay.
If it's a central nodule, it's anyhow very difficult to resect, and then you actually need to biopsy it first and then decide your strategy, because if it's close to the rectal bifurcation on the main bronchus, the resection would anyhow not be indicated, even if there is a malignancy. But in a older patient who's not fit for a surgery, are we going for a non-invasive needle biopsy, either it's a bronchoscopic biopsy or a transthoracic biopsy, and then decide my strategy based on that?
Dr. Arya, since you're a medical oncologist, I wish we could have talked more about immunotherapy and the changing scenario of lung cancer, which has recently seen a sea change.
Yeah, so
US FDA has recently approved the latest drug, 2017, and has changed the scenario completely from a life of maybe about 6 months to a long life.
I think that's a valid point, and I hope I am invited again to talk about that, because I mostly like talking about basic topics rather than the advances.
We could have him again for advances in oncology.
Advances in lung cancer.
The future of lung cancer has changed now.
I think you are absolutely correct. We are. So when I first entered oncology, and it was my first year during my DM residency in 2008, and there was this first paper of which Tata Memorial was also a part, which suggested that probably adenocarcinoma should be treated differently from squamous cell carcinomas. So it was as basic as that. So platinum pemetrexate was better suited for adeno non-squamous, and taxane platinum was better suited, or gem platinum was better suited for adeno. Then came this identification of driver mutations. So we realized that not all cancers are related to squamous. Some of them are because of driver mutations, which now if you list the driver mutation in its entirety, even though EGFR, ALK and ROS1 are the most common, you have HER2NU, you have MET, you have RET, you have DRK, and so on and so forth. So especially in adenocarcinomas or non-squamous, we expect 30 to 40% of these cases to actually have a driver mutation. And as I said before my talk, we now have a drug called osimertinib, which is giving a progression-free survival in EGFR mutated for 18 and a half months.
Yeah.
Immunotherapy is coming up.
In metastatic lung cancer.
In a metastatic lung cancer. That's important. So we are talking about an expected survival, which is about 3 years. So 3 years is not cure. But then when you have a median 3 years survival, you would actually have a curve where you have 10 to 20% patients who are actually alive at 5 years, and that's the definition of cure. So 10 to 20%.
The sea change.
This is what we are talking about.
But stick to the SPM, and this topic should be later.
Thank you.
I would like to add, that you have a radial epus by which you can even approach the peripheral nodules. The central nodules can be approached by the bronchoscopy or epus, and you can even approach the
sir, Dr. Devavrat, your name is all my observations. 20% of the solitary nodules, they are malignant. And 20% of the cancers are diagnosed from solitary nodule situation. Is it okay?
I think the figures would differ from one population to the other.
Approximation. Dr. Mangla has very clearly mentioned the velocity of the increase in the size. So 25%, 26% is one of the significant factors to be worried about, that this much size is increasing. I want to know how much time is required for this much size.
Cancer is about 200 to 400 days. So that's about 6 months to 12 months, right? So that's a doubling time. But if you do a scan earlier than that, and it's still growing, probably by 25%. My take is usually for a centimetric lesion, it should be more than a few millimeters, because eventually these are anatomically lesions. The measurement is which is not very accurate, so there may still be a variation of a millimeter or two. But if it's more than a few millimeters, that's certainly growth, and that certainly is.
Take home message is, if a solitary nodule is symptomatic, it is very important to be followed very aggressively.
Yes, I would paraphrase it. I would say, if you have symptoms in a solitary pulmonary nodule, you treat it as a suspected case of cancer.
Yeah.
Then there is no option of CT surveillance.
Any regression in the size goes against malignancy.
Certainly. But at the same time, a nodule which is a ground glass nodule may be regressing, but is still persisting, would still be considered as suspicious.
So I will stop
Dr. Arya, what is a subcentric nodule 2.5 centimeter in PET versus solitary nodule?
See, sir, the PET CT definition of a solitary pulmonary nodule remains the same. So, most of the times in India, we are talking about PET CT.
What about sub-solitary, sub-centric?
It's the same, sir. Anything less than a centimeter, even on a PET scan. So, PET scan, what it does over and above a CT scan is you know, it shows whether there is an FDG uptake or not.
What is the condition of the patient when the transthoracic biopsy is done?
I mean, you are talking about the possible complications?
Yeah.
So, I think the most commonly talked about complication is a pneumothorax. It would certainly differ, depend on the location, whether it's a cavitary lesion or not, what is the size of the lesion, and the expertise of the interventional radiologist. Studies describe the incidence of pneumothorax as 10 to 30%. We did an analysis at our center, our incidence was about 5%. Majority of them are minor, it can be managed with high flow oxygen. But yes, so there is a risk of pneumothorax, there is a risk of your bleeding as well. But most of the times, it's a very safe procedure.
This is slightly off the topic. You see, suppose a patient who is a heavy smoker, he comes to you with a single episode of bleeding while coughing, and what is the next course of action would you like to do?
Hemoptysis should never be ignored. Even if patient says that he has a URI and had a sneaky hemoptysis, never ignore it. Always followed by a chest X-ray. If the X-ray is negative, you should do a bronchoscopy. You should do a CT scan. And if you don't find anything, and the bleeding is still occurring, you should do a bronchoscopy. More often than not, you will find something.
If there is no episode of bleeding or anything for the next 2 months,
if the CT scan is normal, bronchoscopy is normal.
Would you advise every episode we should go for a CT scan?
If there is a recurrent hemoptysis, then the blood is coming out from somewhere, you will definitely find something.
What would be the next course if I have a patient?
See, you have a patient of hemoptysis,
right.
First do a chest X-ray, find out if he is a smoker, but even if he is not a smoker, and the chest X-ray does not reveal anything, do a CT scan. And if the CT scan is also not showing anything, at least do a bronchoscopy.
The next course, we should be doing a bronchoscopy.
I think I'd add to that, the US Preventive Task Force has come up with screening guidelines. So anybody who's a heavy smoker, means 30 pack years and the Western pack is 20 cigarettes a day, not the 10 that we have here. So a heavy smoker who's currently smoking, or who has quit smoking in the past 15 years, and is more than 55, should actually be subjected to a CT-based screening. They recommend a low-dose CT scan. So annual CT scan till he's 80. So that's the recommendation of the US Preventive Task Force. That's something we haven't quite adopted here because low-dose CT scan but I think that's the recommendation. So if you're doing repeated CT scan, you actually probably that would count as a screening procedure in the West.
Actually, we are talking of ideal conditions. You see, if the patient is asymptomatic, even if you tell that you have a small nodule, and tell him that you have to do a CT scan, you have to do a bronchoscopy, he may not agree at times.
No, because I lost this patient, he came up with a fusion about 9 months later.
Yes.
The CT scan was normal, the X-ray was normal, and 9 months later he came with a massive effusion on one side of the chest. And I lost him after about 4 months.
Bronco was also
normal. The bronco I
didn't know. A lot of times, you know, there would be central lesions. If it's a small lesion, intrabronchial growth, the CT scan will miss it.
I would certainly
subject that to a problem.
Sir, two questions. One is, solitary nodule, symptomatic versus asymptomatic. How aggressive you are in a symptomatic solitary nodule?
Equally aggressive. If you find a nodule, symptomatic or not symptomatic, you will investigate this patient and look for the speculations, look for calcification, and if it is definitely you will do a CT scan, you will like to do a bronchoscopy, or these days, you know, radio nevus is available. So you can approach these nodules. Because transthoracic, if the nodule is in the center, then you are traversing a lot of lung tissue, there is a definite risk of pneumothorax, definite risk of bleeding. But that you can always manage. But by nevus, the complication rates are less.
sir, in a country where we see a very high prevalence of pox, a subpleural nodule, how do you proceed with that?
See, at times you have to decide whether it is an extra pleural, whether it is in the lung tissue at all. So if it is making an obtuse angle with the chest wall, it is likely to be extra pleural. Otherwise, you know, subpleural nodules are very easy to do a CT carried affinacy, but there are less risk of pneumothorax. Otherwise, bad procedures, you will be able to see and take biopsies.
My question is, is there any role of surgery, number one, and what is the kind of surgery? I know you are a medical oncologist, but would you go for a segmental dissection or lobectomy or complete lung removal, something
like that? So I think we need to differentiate. The guidelines recommend that in a fit patient, when your probability of suspicion is high, or the patient wants a definitive diagnosis, you should do a surgical resection, which can be a wedge resection. That should be subjected to a frozen section. If the frozen section is positive, then you can actually do a segmentectomy or lobectomy depending on the location of the patient and the judgment of the surgeon, and add a mediastinal lymph node resection. So initially it has to be just a wedge resection of the nodule, because you're trying to resect the minimum possible part of lung parenchyma, at the same time take out the entire. But in an unfit patient, or where the probability of malignancy is lesser, the patient is not keen, and that's when you probably would go in for a biopsy, whether it's a transthoracic or a bronchoscopy or even.
It's a long time back, way back in 1977, when Dr. Sanjeev Reddy became our president. I don't know if you remember it or not.
He had a nodule
in the lungs immediately after he was sworn in as president. He was flown to America, and where his resection was done, and he went on to survive about 10 to 12 years after that with those primitive treatment modalities. We had discussed about 3 years survival and 5 years survival. That fellow went on to live more than 10 to 12 years after the resection was. It was not
primitive. See, the resection is done. Sir, that was 77. You can imagine, 40 years back. Yeah, he went for the resection. But then, sir, he went on to live for more than 15 years. And that is the. I'll actually discuss a case. So, this patient was actually having headache and giddiness. Presented to a neurologist first. The neurologist was at her bedside because she'd done everything, CSF, MRI, brain, everything had been done, and nothing was coming out. And she then asked me whether I should do a PET scan. And I don't know what's the indication. So eventually a PET scan was done. And there was a very tiny nodule, which was about, I think, 13 or 14 millimeters in size in the peripheral region. Basically a subpleural nodule. Came to me very hot on the FDG. We did an FNA, the FNA was positive, so the radiologist was not sure, the patient initially was not keen for a VACS. We did an FNA was positive. We did a wedge resection, it was actually certainly positive for adenocarcinoma. And then I did a CSF again, this time a second CSF, the pathologist said, suspicious. We eventually did a meningeal biopsy, the meningeal biopsy was positive, it was adeno IHC twice similar. So 1.5 centimeter subpleural nodule, and you have meningeal metastasis, a leptomeningeal metastasis. So I think it all depends on the stage.
That is why you give a radiotherapy to the brain also when you have.
So that would depend on the subtype of lung cancer. In small cell lung cancer, you have a 20% possibility of there being a lung met. So there's a role of preventive renal irradiation. It's not that frequently done in non-small cell lung cancers, even in.
I have just two cases to talk, Dr. Mangla and Dr. Arya. I practiced in Nizamuddin for 14 years, and the place where I practiced, that doctor's elder brother, an engineer in Saudi Arabia, he came back from there with chest pain. He was referred to Escorts Hospital, and he had triple vessel disease. He was advised bypass surgery by Dr. Trehan. He was seen by Dr. Vikram Sarabhai in Escorts, and there was a solitary nodule on the right feet of the lung. Dr. Vikram Sarabhai advised him that he should go a CT scan, he should go an FNAC before you proceed for bypass. And then this patient got very, very confused. He took discharge, came back, and he asked me, what should I do? They are asking me to, apart from CABG, they are asking me to do so many things. I told him, please do whatever they are asking. He said, no, I just want a bypass. I have about 20 days vacation, and I want to do my bypass. Please get my bypass done. He insisted. Okay. He said, get a CT scan done, and get a PET scan done. We got his CT scan done, and his FDG PET done. There were no secondaries at that time, let me tell you. And he had a probable nodule in the right lung, which sir said, Dr. Arsijan said, that this is malignancy. It needs to be removed. Sir did a pneumonectomy, hemi-pneumonectomy on that side, sent the nodule, and it turned out to be an adenocarcinoma. And sir said, Dr. Chauhan, I am telling you, this man has a survival of not more than 3-4 years, I am telling you. And unless the cause of pain was not triple vessel disease, it was this adenocarcinoma. This man died after 3 years. He had very, very bad kind of course after that. But what I want to know, what I want to tell you people is that if you have a patient with chest pain, he may have a triple vessel disease, please investigate the solitary pulmonary nodule. And Dr. Vikram Sarabhai told me, Dr. Chauhan, he is insisting for a bypass, but I can tell you the cause may not be triple vessel disease. One, this is one case, okay? The second case that I want to tell you is, it's a lady, about 50 years old. This man is very near to my clinic in Munerka. He brings his mother and he says, my mother has a problem and she has a brain tumor. Okay. She is admitted in Gangaram. I refer them to Dr. Rana Patil, one of the best neurosurgeons that we have in North India. She has a pulmonary nodule. Now he wants my opinion about this pulmonary nodule. I tell them that you please clarify this pulmonary nodule before you get the surgery done for the brain. What is the diagnosis of the brain? They are saying this is a glioma. I refer that case to Dr. Bhagwa for an opinion from Dr. Raghavan, the neurologist. He says, no, I am not very sure. This is a glioma or this is a metastasis. I would like to clarify this nodule first. He takes an opinion from one of his friends in USA. And he says, no, I don't think this lung condition is really very important. I think you go ahead and get the surgery done. Remove the glioma. Okay. They remove the glioma. It turns out to be a metastatic small cell carcinoma from the lung. Then they go retrospectively. See her x-rays. These lesions have been there from the past. This lady died in 1 year. Sir, your comments.
This is very important. I think this talk has increased the sensitivity of all of us. As and when you have a solitary pulmonary nodule, and you should not imagine that if a patient has seen you, if he gets well, it's fine. If he doesn't get well, then it is somebody's business. But if you have given one prescription, you are responsible. So if you are sensitive, you have advised that this should be investigated. That is very important. I would just like to add, one of the nurses' husband, who had a chest pain, underwent bypass surgery,
pain did not get better. And then every time she will go, he will go for a chest pain, the angiography will be done, hamara kuch nahi. Finally, it was shown to my brother. He said, where is the chest X-ray? Would you believe chest X-ray was not traceable? And finally, which they traced, it had a lesion, Benkos tumor, under the rib. And when the new X-ray was done, it had spread, you know, destroyed all the... It was all due to the, you know, nerve irritation. So one should be very sensitive to that.